The remains of an Old West fort in Far West Nevada reminds visitors of a more volatile time in U.S. history. Fort Churchill State Park displays what's left of a military fort, established as a show of force against hostile natives of the area, as well as to protect travelers seeking their fortunes out west. A true gem for Old West enthusiasts. As Fort Churchill is out in the wide open Great Basin country, if you guessed it's kind of remote, you'd be correct. This makes overnight camping a great option.
Howdy folks, it's Glenn with the Cactus Atlas coming at you with another campground episode here at Fort Churchill State Park. I'm gonna start our tour today. I'm gonna switch it up a little bit. I'm not gonna be as like, do everything in the exact same order every time just to mess with you guys. Those that have been around and have enjoyed these videos since their inception. We're gonna start off by looking at the dump station today, but also the views. That's really what I wanted to come and see, which you get to see good views at the dump station. I mean, looky here. Now all of these lush trees, these cottonwood trees out here, are not the usual look and feel of the region out here. Don't let that fool you. It looks more like what you see beyond. Out that away is just those sagebrush looking things. Not sagebrush, I always forget what those things are, but some kind of bush and big mountains. Oh, and by the way, for you, those of you in a rig of some sort or camper, here's your dump station. Really wasn't the main thing I wanted to come see, but I think it's pretty self-explanatory. This is one of those first come, first serve campgrounds. Although there's a sign up here saying there is a reservation system coming soon. Finally, thank you. Because it's these state parks, like Valley of Fire, for example, is a really stressful one because it's so popular and it's such a bummer when you get there and a campground is full. So I'm always worried about that, but I had no issues and there's still plenty of vacant sites, plenty that we'll be able to explore in this episode. So let's get down here to the starting point and I'll explain how we're doing this. Quick disclaimer, it is late afternoon and there are quite a few folks that have bunked up here for the night, especially those with like campers and stuff. So that's gonna be helpful for those of you that aren't necessarily tent campers. But as a tent camper, my goal in these episodes is to try to point out sites that work well for tents, because I camp in a tent and there's a fly flying around me here. So that's kind of the gig if you haven't seen one of these before. And your fee is covers camping and entrance per vehicle per night. Nevada vehicles, you get to pay 15 bucks. People like me that don't live in Nevada pay 20 bucks. If you're just coming for the day, it's 5 Nevada, 10 non-Nevada. Same price as Berlin Ichthyosaur, in fact, I believe. And of course, because there are people camping, I do like to give people their privacy so I don't go poking around their sites if they're occupied. We'll kind of just casually walk by, but I'm not gonna scrutinize all of them. I can't. We're gonna make my way to my campsite, but we are gonna pass a few vacant sites on the way, so I don't wanna squander the opportunity before others show up. But you can see this very first site. I don't know, there's no number there, so I wonder if it's a host. I think it is, yeah, they sell firewood there, so that must be a campground host. That's an unnumbered site. But over here would be the first official site, site number one. We'll scrutinize the amenities at my campsite, but you already see your picnic table and the two grills. I think pretty standard with Nevada State Parks, Valley of Fire, Berlin Ichthyosaur, and now here they all have the same format. You get those items that you see there. You could pull in a pretty long rig back here, not gonna say a Class A, but what I do like about this one is for the tent camper, as long as you don't mind some loss of privacy, but their rig blocks a lot of it, although they could watch you while they eat. This is nice flat ground, sizable enough for a tent, probably like an 8-person tent. Could fit there, maybe even bigger if you're crafty about it. And you got more room here, you know, lots of flat space, lots of options to plop a tent if you're not in a big rig. And now that we're under here, you really have to stop every once in a while and admire trees, green trees. Us desert dwellers don't get to experience this often, so It's a not, this is what's novel to me. I was reading their policies on their site, and they do talk about walk-in customers and bikers, meaning bicyclists, I believe. They are always guaranteed a site here. They will never turn away a biker, which is a good policy, but I'm assuming this is reserved specifically for people like that. They got mulch here, much softer ground than the other one. So I guess it's good to know if you're a biker and this is on your stop, this might be your site. It's not a numbered site. We've seen site number one. I see site number two coming up, and this one's just the walk-in and bike site. It's not numbered, not part of the 20, by the way, 20 sites here at this campground. Down the road is site number two, and there's a water spigot here, which I don't think my site has a spigot, so I'm wondering if this is a shared spigot, but if you're staying at this campsite, we'll see if it works. Some parks don't run water all the time. It does. It works very well. This site, site number two, is excellent for tent campers. I would say lots of flat space, really good for a large tent. The only gripe that I would have is I noticed when I was shopping for sites earlier when I arrived is you've got no tree cover, very little tree cover. You got that, but compared to other sites, you're exposed. And I saw when the sun was out, this would have been a hot mess if you're hanging out here during the day, if you don't have some kind of canopy. And right across the way from this nice site over here is site number three, which happens to be the one that I chose to camp in tonight. So this is my site, site number three, and there are several criteria that made me want this site, and I'll explain all of them to you. And there's one major selling point that just was the cherry on top. Of course, you have a picnic table, but who really needs a picnic table when I'm gonna show you one of the amenities that I'm gonna call it special amenity at this particular campsite. Now, next to it, you have your stand-up grill. You can see it's recently been used, but they don't have any fire restrictions at this place. I'm assuming because it's so lush, there must be enough water down here to not worry about the place burning down. But that's a nice thing to have, as well as a campfire with another attached grate, which my tent, yes, is right next to the campfire, but I do not plan on making a fire. Now, it's a nice cozy site, and some of you may be already making a comment in your mind about my tent placement today, why I chose to do it there. My original plan was indeed what some of you may have been thinking, is this looks like a great place for a tent. As you could tell, others have camped here. And I agreed, and this is where I started off. But I noticed the ground has little like holes in it, uneven holes like here. And other debris, it even has like, someone trimmed away some of the growth here, but really sharp, stubby wooden things sticking out of the ground. So I didn't, and there's like one there. So I didn't want to rip my tent up. So I decided to move it over here to flatter, more stable ground. This whole area was just kind of like packed dirt also, making me think others have made the same decision in the past. But it's awful handy too, because what I was doing, I moved the car back here temporarily, but I parked the car over here. So when I'm packing up the tent, it's really easy to do so. Now the amenity that I wanted to show you, the special amenity, is this thing here. I was like, this is curious, but I think someone did this deliberately. And I think I see what they tried to do. Basically, you get a table, like a booth at a restaurant, if you think about it. Like, that's the little table in the middle. Maybe you could lay something flat across the top to extend its reach. And you could have your little family sit on the inside of this thing. Maybe put like a padded thing down on for your seat. It's hard, but it's stable. Now, I think I said there are multiple selling points for site number three. And the other one was, I like my privacy. So there's like a dense grove and a lot of vegetation here, creating many sight lines blocked and a lot of space, a lot of distance. So, you know, to distance me from the sound of generators like they were running for a while, which isn't troublesome, you know, during regular hours, but it's just nice, you know, to have your own breathing space. And the closest site, I think, is site number two, which if you park your car there or your truck, that'll block the view if you want privacy. So either way you go, I think this is a nice private site. Anyway, I did check too. This tree seems plenty sturdy and healthy. Because that would be horrible if that fell on me in the middle of the night. That would be the end of me. So what I think I'm going to do now is just walk around and we'll take a look at some of the other sites here. I was thinking earlier when I come to these campgrounds that are first come, first serve, and it's almost like, what's the point of doing these episodes? Because you can't make decisions in advance. You might be forced to make a choice. But now that the reservation system is coming, I'm like, aha, so Berlin Ichthyosaur might be one that has reservations in the future. So this is actually good timing, Nevada. And here is site 4, another one that's kind of outside of the thicket of trees. It's got a little bit more than site number 2, but a nice flat area, you know. You might have to park your car partially on here, but if you're a tent camper once again and you want level ground, this one's totally fine. And I would say not as private. You can see like people, you're gonna have a straight line to people. Maybe your car would block the view. And then of course you're gonna have me across the way to deal with, but if you're hanging out over here, you got some stuff to block the way. Although someone cut that little hole out there, I know it, so you could spy on site number 3, didn't you? Then site number 5, also adjacent to mine, but look how far back the actual site is, you know, so that's why mine is still, I maintain, is very private. But basically site number 5, you know, so far the sites are all flat, I'll give them that. And if you were a tent camper, this is an excellent choice, I would say, mainly because you have this nice driveway. You could park your car here and then you could easily put a nice sized tent like right here or over there, unless you have the same situation that I do and you don't want to. But this is a nice site, other than you do have some privacy concerns. Now, since Amy and I decided to do more campground episodes and I'm mixing them in with my other travels now, we decided to maybe kind of simplify things and just do more classic style, how I used to do these videos where I go site to site and show you most of them, the ones that I can, unless it's like a 200 site campground or something. I got a different idea for that. So you just want to be clear, that's what we're doing here today, is really just focusing on the campground more than anything else. So now that I'm looking at site 6 on my drive-by, it didn't really stand out to me, but another decent choice, not only for a tent camper, but for you know, all of these sites, or most of them, are good for rigs, like really long, nice driveways. So, but if you were a tent camper, this would be a nice choice. Plenty of level, flat space, and this gigantic cottonwood tree. I hope these are actually cottonwood trees. That's what the website says, is that it's in a grove of cottonwood trees. So if I'm wrong, don't blame me. And I was wondering where the restrooms were in proximity to my campsite, because I hadn't seen them yet. I think I just located them. So basically there I am, and there's site number 4 across the street, site number 5, site number 6, all likely patrons of the same restroom up here. Okay, so they do have separate ones for different genders. So we'll go into the men's room. See what we're dealing with. Not expecting water, by the way. It is quite dark in here, though. So you probably need to bring your own lighting. There's no electricity. And that is a vault toilet. But from what I can see, it's very clean. There's no odor, because thankfully someone keeps the seat down. And then I guess, tell me, is that a urinal? I'm gonna guess that's a urinal. And of course, when you kind of come up from being down in this little nook, you get those views that I wanted to start the video off with. So we'll take a moment to breathe it all in. And this is site number 7. You can see one where you have a camper in it. So hopefully that's helpful. If you have one of those and want to know what you can get here, that's a big one. It's a really big one. Site number 8, right there. Site number 9 on the left. And then site number 10 are occupied. Here you get to see a tent and a camper together. There's another tent with a camper. Site number 9. And a vacant one. This one Once again, it's flat. And I would say this is good for big rig and a tent. Like, do it like those people, have one of each. And of course you have this forest here. It's very beautiful. I imagine in the autumn you can see some leaves maybe starting to change. This place is probably a wonderland. Here's a smaller site. This one I might flag as a tent camper's delight. Site 14, right across from site 15. So over here, the privacy is maybe not as good, and a lot more rigs on this side, actually, probably because the campgrounds where I'm at, the sites are smaller, I take it. So maybe if you're in a tent, consider that. If you're setting up early, or maybe I'll regret it, I don't know. But this is a cozy little site. When you have a big rig like that, most people hang out and do their stuff on the other side of it, so. And you're right next to a trail that goes to the Carson River, quarter mile. And it's nicely shaded back here. Here's another vacant one. This one I think would be really good for a tent camper, 17, or a really large rig, pretty straight driveway. And then you've got this nice tucked away area. I honestly may, if I noticed this earlier, this would have been a contender for sure. Although you do have folks right over here, but there's good blocking of sight lines over here. You're close to a toilet and plenty of space. And then there's the other site. I really couldn't show it because there's people hanging out back there across the street. And I think we're winding it down, folks. We're getting close to the last site. We're not done with the video yet, but this here is site 18. Get a decent sized rig in this one too. And like all of them, so many places to put a tent. If you're primarily a tent camper, all of these are totally fine. There's almost nothing that wouldn't work in this whole place. Two more to go, 19. This one has a envelope on it. Oh, it's reserved. This one's pretty sweet. That one goes way back there. Now there's somebody on that, but that might be the most private. That one wins the award for the most private, I would say, is site 19. It's uncannily back there. I would say if that was available, I almost certainly would choose that just because it's so isolated and I could see there's plenty of places to put a tent, but I'd feel guilty too because you could get probably like two or three class A's in here line by line. So like your largest size rig, if you want the easiest time, this one might be one to consider. Another restroom. This one's more in the style of the ones we had at Berlin Ichthyosaur. I'm just curious, that's all gender. Yep, exactly like Berlin Ichthyosaur. And I can tell you they're very clean and the odor is very low unless someone leaves the seat open. And our last site on the tour is paved. It's a handicap accessible site. Very sizable driveway. Really nice. Although this area is not paved, sometimes they'll even pave that. It's very flat and clear of obstructions. It's got its own water spigot. And you have a paved path devoted to getting straight to the restroom. Ooh, we did it. We actually made it. Toured the campground. Now that we did our walk around on foot, I need to go fuel me up. I need to go find somewhere to buy some ice. And when I was driving in here, I noticed at least one gas station. It wasn't terribly far away. And I was even remarking to myself, yeah, I'd come back here. It's not like being at Berlin Ichthyosaur where you're completely cut off from society. So anyway, let's go drive. I'll drive you through the campground really quick and you can get yourself another look at it. Say bye to the tent for now. Bye, tent at site number 3. We'll take the long way through. I could make a right here. Not into site number 5, but right here in the middle, and that's like the loop number 1, I guess. If you want to think of it that way. If you think of a big figure 8, I'm on the bottom of that 8.
and all sites that we saw, but maybe it's helpful to see it from the vehicle for whatever reason. I see a bunch of tents behind back there, these hiking trails, and I'm thinking they are a group campsite. And now the sun's really starting to make its presence known. Thank goodness I finished all of the labor for today, the majority of it. It's a small campground, you know, 20 sites. Doesn't take long to drive through it, not like being at the Grand Tetons or somewhere where the campsites have like 200 sites. I'd have to devote 2 days to documenting that kind of thing. And now we're heading back out into the beautiful desert. Oh, it's good to know they do have a dumpster also, because I think that's the only trash I've seen the whole time. I didn't call any out. So at least they have that. They don't expect you to pack out your trash. I knew there was a reason why we came this way. Well, I was going to say while there's daylight left, there's plenty of daylight right now. Ouch. Aye, aye, aye. But before we finish up here, I do want to take you guys to see something that I think is pretty neat. I'd say it's the main draw, the main reason to come here. And you will understand what I'm talking about shortly. Because as we said, Fort Churchill is a state park. So usually state parks have a reason for being. Sometimes they're here for scenic beauty, which you have that, but also for history. Oftentimes history from forgotten eras and times where nobody's left to tell the tale. Here's the main draw to Fort Churchill, which is the remains of Fort Churchill. It's an archaeological resource area. So here's a look. We have another video where we explore probably a little more deeply and talk about some of the history a little bit that you may have seen. If you haven't, you can certainly always go check it out if it's been released. But this is the remains of an old fort from the 1860s that was built out here to protect people traveling on California emigrant trail of the time and the Pony Express, things like that. Coming out here to take a peek at some of these structures is also a good reason, a good excuse, I should say, to admire this landscape. So over here is another row of leftover foundations, adobe brickwork, and some restoration work of all that's left of this fort from a long forgotten era. And I did another video, I think I mentioned already, where we walked that whole row over there, and I promised I'd come over here and look at some of these for those that are completionists like me. The other side was really devoted to officers and officers' families and things like that, and commanding officers. And over here, this must be more about the common grunts. This would be the barracks, where the common soldiers would have stayed. Take a quick peek. Yeah, it's all overgrown on the inside of these, and it almost seems like they put some kind of veneer on the outside. It's really hard, like concrete-like material. But you can see, kind of embedded in the walls, some of the original brickwork. And some of the original wood still left in the windows. Anybody else have the feeling these are all barracks? There was a mess hall. Over here you still see a lump of where the walls would have been, melted adobe brick basically. And over here, more barracks. So I certainly think this is where the main soldiers were all stationed. And if you look off this ways, that's where the campground is. You see all those trees.
The Carson River runs through here. It's a quarter mile away from the campground, so I think that's why there are so many cottonwood trees all up and down this valley here. It's because of the river providing its water. And you can see the difference. There would have been yet another building similar to these standing here that's no longer here anymore. Now that's arrested decay in action. And I guess kind of a similar idea with a mess hall. You have the mess hall remains here, and there was another mess hall right next door. So we kind of get a glimpse. I imagine it was a facsimile of this thing. So it says there were living quarters for one company of approximately 100 men with three buildings. There was plans to have up to six, but they were only partially finished by 1860. So, but it talks about how you would have sets of barracks with a accompanying mess hall. So that's probably why there's multiple ones. But I think that you get the gist of it over here on this side. I would say the other side is slightly more interesting to me, although this is still really, really amazing and cool. Since this is a camping episode, I mean, it's only proper to hang out at all times. But I wanted to show you where the magic happens, as they said on MTV Cribs back in the day. But the magic here isn't what you think. It's reviewing itineraries, reading, and different types of activities like that. But I have my cot set up, so you can get a look at my setup inside of the new tent that I purchased. If you haven't heard about that, I just bought a larger version of the same thing that I had, a 6-person instead of a 4-person, to better accommodate the space. And I just realized I did a boneheaded thing, and I put my charging regimen, my jackery, and my lighting that I use to read books and stuff over here instead of at the other side of the bed, because last night I had everything reversed and the other way around because of a slant on a hill. What do you know about that? Another awesome thing is I can almost stand up completely in here. I'm 6'2". If I push the tent up a little bit, I can. But it's the other one was more like this, so it makes it a lot easier to set my stuff up. It makes sense. I mean, this is in lieu of a hotel, and I like comfort, so this is how we do it around these parts. When it's not too cold, I usually just use my sleeping bag as a base and my blanket. It's a southwestern pattern giant blanket as a cover, and that usually gets me through. Top of the morning to you all. It's the next day. Spent the night here at the campground at Fort Churchill State Park. And you can see the tent is gone. So we have to move on down the road. And you know what that means. That's the end of this particular video. But overall, I like to save my final words until after I spend the night, just in case something bad happens over the night. But nothing bad happened at all. Slept extremely well once again. Very quiet. Everybody here went to bed early. It's a really nice place, so I can't recommend it enough. Whether you're here to visit Fort Churchill or you just need a place to lay your head at night, this campground will do you right. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week. Bye.